Hello friends, in this video we are going to solve some numerical based on mean terms and max term. Let us begin. See the question number 1 carefully. Question number 1 says, consider some function consist of the given input variables which are u, v, w, x, y and z. Now for these variables, you have to write expression for M53 and M15. Look at this M very carefully. This M is a capital M. When they say it is capital M, you should understand they are talking about max term. Meaning that these U, V, W, X, Y, Z, these are what? These are input variables. What M stands for? Come on, M stands for what? Max term. And what this 53 stands for? That 53 stands for a particular decimal position. For that particular decimal position, U, V, W, X, Y, Z will have some binary combination. I hope you understand my point. That is, if you remember, on a smaller scale, I can make you understand like this. For example, if AB is 0, 0. Then we say that the decimal position is 0 and the max term is called as M0. If the decimal position is 1, then AB combination is 0, 1 and the respective max term is called as capital M1. Like that. Now you don't have two variables. You have got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 variables are there. Isn't it? There are 6 variables out of which you have to select that combination of U, V, W, X, Y, Z where the decimal position will be 53. So, U, V, W, X, Y, Z. Isn't it? You got these 6 variables. The first combination will be all zeros. Definitely, this will have decimal position equal to what? Common sense, 0. And this will continue up to all ones. This will go up to all ones. Obviously, the decimal position over here will be what? It will be 63. That is from 0 to 63. These are total 64 combinations. And for every combination, you will get one max term. You will get one max term. Out of which, they are asking you two max terms. That is M15 and M53. On which, definitely we can say, first of all, somewhere over here you will get decimal position 15, for which the binary combination is what? It is 1 1 1 1, and of course the rest of the terms would be equal to what? 0. For this, now you have to write what? You have to write a max term equation, or I would say a max term for M15. So now I'll teach you how to write M15. Now look at this. For this decimal position, this is the binary combination, and for this binary combination, let me write M15. You know that you always write max term in the form of sum. You write mean term in the form of product. Since it is a max term, you have to write it in the form of sum. Also, try to understand that when it is 0, we take that variable as it is. Whenever it is 1, we complement that variable. What does that mean? This will be like this. That is U plus V plus W bar plus X bar plus Y bar plus Z bar, because the input combination should be taken in such a way that it must result into 0. Therefore, wherever there are 1s, we take a complement of it in order to make it 0, and wherever they are 0, we take those variables as it is. I hope you understood my point. So, obviously, when you are progressing ahead, even ahead of 15. So somewhere in between, you will get decimal position equal to 53. So somewhere here, you will get decimal position 53, somewhere over here. If you don't understand directly how to write a binary combination for this, on top of this, you can write 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32. Isn't it? Now for 15, try to understand. 8 plus 4 plus 2 plus 1 is 15. In a way, you have written 1s below 8, 4, 2, 1. Isn't it? Similarly, for 53, what you are going to do? Let us see. For 53, first of all, you will write 1 below 32. Isn't it? Below 32, you can write 1. Then below 16 also you can write 1. So try to understand, I have to reach up to 53. So far you have added 32 with 16. So how much it gives you? It gives you 48. And don't forget that you have to go for 53 only. Since you have to achieve 53, you don't require 8. Yes or no? Then if you add 4, to this, then this will be equal to what? 52. And this is what we were looking for. Okay, we are not even looking for 52. We are looking for 53. So far the addition is 52. If we write one more 1 here, then only it will become 53. So plus 1, it will become 53. So meaning that this will be 0, isn't it? And by using the similar logic, now I'm going to write a max term expression for M15. So let me write it. Observe this and write the expression for M53. So what it will be? Just check it out. U is equal to 1. So I need to write U bar plus V is equal to 1. So I need to again write V bar plus W equal to 0. Take it as it is plus. This is 1. Then I have to take, X bar plus Y is 0. Take it as it is. Z is 1. Take it Z bar. This is how we have written expression for M53. I'm sure you have understood how do we write expression for M53 or M15 or any possible max term. Okay, even though in future if they ask you for mean term, you're not going to write it in the form of sum, you are going to write it in the form of product. Also, wherever there is bar, you have to consider zero, or vice versa. Wherever you find variable zero, take a bar. Wherever you find variable equal to 1, consider as uncomplemented. This is what I'm saying in the context of min term. The question over here was related to max term. So I'm sure now you have understood this question. Let's move to the next question. The next question says, using n number of input variables, how many Boolean functions are possible or can be formed? Let's see. They are saying that n number of input variables. Okay, so with n number of input variables, how many Boolean functions can be formed to get that, that you actually get a function with the help of minterm and maxterm. So let's go for a minterm approach. Let's say, let's consider on a smaller scale. Let us assume n value equal to 2. What is n? N means number of inputs. Now with these two inputs, that is, let's say A and B, will have 4 possible combinations, that is 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. So there are 4 possible combinations, and for every combination, we will get minterm. Minterm 0, minterm 1, minterm number 2, minterm number 3. So you know that actually for n number of inputs, you have 2^n number of minterms. I hope you remember that. So here we have total 4 possible minterms. Now let me tell you, even though there are 4 minterms, I repeat, even though there are 4 main terms, for writing the output expression or to write a Boolean expression, you don't consider all main terms. You consider only those main terms for which output is 1. I repeat, even though there are 4 main terms, you are not going to make use of all main terms there. You are going to make use of only those main terms for which the output is logic 1. Right now, unfortunately, I don't know what is Y. So Y is a question mark for me. I don't know for which combination of AB, Y is possibly 1. I don't know. So since I don't know, what I have to do, I have to consider all the cases. And I'll have to see how many Boolean functions can be formed. That is, let me take M0, M1, M2 and M3. And here I'm going to write expression Y. So let me tell you exactly what I'm trying to do. For example, I'm writing 0000 here. What does that mean? For every min term which is listed over here, outputs were 0000. If outputs were 0000, what does that mean? For writing the output equation, I cannot write even a single min term. So I can actually write y equal to always 0. So y can be possibly 0. Okay, y can be possibly 0. It is also called as y is null, also denoted like this. This is one possible combination I can write. Next what I can do is let me assume 0001, meaning that consider y was 0 here, y was 0 here, y was 0 here, y is 1 only once. What does that mean? Now I can write y equal to what? M3. And what is M3? Come on, it is a into b. So this is one Boolean expression I can write for y. So possible y value is what? It is equal to ab. This is one Boolean expression. Next what I can do is I can consider combination as 0010, for example, isn't it? Now for 0010, what does that mean? That for m0 it is 0, for m1 it is 0, for m2 it is 1, and for m3 it is 0. What does that mean? Now while writing the output expression, I can express my m2 or y equal to m2, which is equal to what? It is ab bar. So this is the another Boolean expression possible. Yes or no? What does that mean? Over here for 0011, like 0100, 0101, and even though we go up to all ones, for every combination, you will get one Boolean expression. Yes or no? So we have to see such how many possible combinations are there. That is, if you see, these are total 16 possible combinations. That is from all zeros to all ones. For these 16 possible combinations, you are getting 16 Boolean functions. You are getting 16 Boolean functions just because there are 4 min terms. I repeat, since there are 4 min terms, you are getting 2^4 Boolean functions. You are getting 2^4 Boolean functions. But don't forget, at the same time, we had only 2 inputs. So in a way, I can say that for 2 inputs, you are getting 16 possible Boolean functions. Don't forget, we have to make it general. We have to consider n. What does that mean? In future, suppose if I consider n equal to 3, it indicates number of input variables are 3. So the number of mean terms are what? It is, 2^3, which is nothing but 8. Meaning that you will have m0 to m7. Now this m0s to m7 will have all zeros to all ones combination. And every combination gives you what? Every combination gives you one Boolean function. Meaning that here, if you see, 2^8 possible combinations are there. And what is 2^8? Come on, guys. What is 2^8? It is 64. So you will have 64 possible combinations or 64 possible Boolean functions. I hope you are understanding my point. What does that mean? It means that in general, for n variables, I can say that number of Boolean functions possible is always equal to 2^2 number of min terms. That is, in this case, check it out. In this case, there are total 8 min terms. So 2^8 combinations you are getting, or 2^8 number of Boolean functions possible. Yes or no? Let's go back to the previous example. I said that the number of Boolean functions that you get is 2^2 min terms. And how many min terms were there? Come on. Here, there were 4 min terms, m0 to m3. So 2^4. How much it is? 16. So try to understand my point. What I'm actually saying, that the number of Boolean functions possible is always equal to 2^ what? Number of min terms possible. But don't forget, the number of min terms are equal to nothing but 2^n. So let us replace number of min terms equal to 2^n, meaning that these are the number of Boolean functions possible. These are the number of Boolean functions possible for n input variables. I hope you understood my point. Okay. I hope you understood my point. So it is 2 to the power 2 to the power n, or 2 raised to 2 to the power n is the number of Boolean functions possible, where n is number of input variables. I hope you got my point. Let's move to the next question. So now they are asking us to convert y equal to function of a comma b comma c equal to c plus ab bar plus a bar b bar c into canonical SOP form. To solve this question, let us understand what is meant by a canonical SOP form. Look at this. So our aim is to first of all understand that SOP, that is sum of products, can be considered into two categories. One is only called as non-canonical form, and the other one is called as a canonical form, also called as a standard form or standard SOP form. So what is meant by that? Try to understand. One thing is very clear, that this is, you know, SOP. SOP stands for sum of products. That is nothing but these are sums of what? Individual product. So non-canonical form I can consider y is equal to, let's say, you know, AB plus AB bar C plus ABC, like that. So the reason why it is called as non-canonical or non-standard, because if you overall say in this expression, there are total three variables, that is A comma B comma C. There are total how many variables? Three variables. But if you see at term wise here, can't you see that C is missing? C is missing. Here, all the three variables are cleared. I mean, all the three variables are considered. So we are okay with the second term. If you look at the third term, as you can see, all the variables are covered. Maybe in complemented or uncomplemented form, it doesn't matter. But all the variables must be covered in every term. So we are satisfied with third term also, but we are not satisfied with the very first term because C was missing. In this case, whenever a single term is missing, whenever a single variable is missing in any term, then it is called as a non-canonical form. Whereas a canonical form can be written like this: AB plus A bar B plus AB, or let's say A bar B bar. So as you can see, overall there are only two variables, and every term you will see that all the variables are covered. Or, you know, you can write like this. Let's say there are three variables x, y and z, x bar y z plus x y bar z plus x y bar z bar, like that. So as you can see there are total three variables possible, x, y, z, and there are three terms, that is term number one, in which x, y, z are considered. I mean, all the three variables are considered. Again, in the second term, as you can see, all the three variables are considered. In third term also, as you can see, x, y, z, all of them are considered. Again, it is not necessary whether it is in complemented form or uncomplemented form. It doesn't matter. Over here, okay, I cannot write y over here. Let me write some other variable, let's say w. Okay, because y is something which is used here. You cannot write expression like that. For example, if I write over here w equal to x, y bar z plus x, y plus y bar z. Now this is something called as what? Non-canonical form. Why? Because we are satisfied with the first term, because all the three variables are covered. But if you look at the second term, as you can see, the z is missing. And in the third term, as you can see, the x is missing. Meaning that all variables in every term should be covered, whether it is complemented or uncomplemented form, doesn't matter. I hope you are understanding my point. So let's go ahead and let's understand how to convert the given SOP form or given non-standardized SOP form into standard form or a canonical form. So one thing is clear, that in the first term, as you can see, A and B are missing. In second term, C is missing. In third term, we are satisfied that nothing is missing. A, B, C, all of them are covered. So let's move ahead and let me make you understand how do we actually convert it into standard form or canonical form. Let's begin. So let me just rewrite the question. The question was y equal to function of a comma b comma c, which is equal to c plus ab bar plus abc. In fact, it is a bar b bar c. Okay, let me just confirm. Okay, c plus ab bar plus A bar, B bar, C. It is correct. So over here, you should understand what is missing. AB is missing. Here, what is missing? C is missing. And over here, nothing is missing. I mean, third term, there is nothing missing. That is A bar, B bar, C. So let me write it with different color, whatever variables are missing. So in first case or in first term, A and B are missing. In third case, C is missing. I'm sorry, in second case, C is missing. In first case, A and B are missing. In third term, nothing is missing. So I'm not going to include a different color there. Okay. Now, to go with that, first of all, try to understand which variables are rigid. Which variables are rigid means what? It is C. It is in complemented form or uncomplemented form? As you can see, it is in uncomplemented form. If you remember, in mean term, we follow that logic. If a particular variable value is 1, it is written in uncomplemented form. Now think vice versa. If a particular variable is written in uncomplemented form, its logical value is 1, meaning that the C value is fixed to 1. Similarly, for A, since it is uncomplemented form, it has to be 1. B is written in uncomplemented or complemented form? Complemented form. So it has to be 0. Over here, A bar means it has to be 0. B bar means it has to be 0. C, it is in uncomplemented form. I must write this as 1. I hope you are clear with that. Rest, as you can see, rest of the variables are missing, right? Now those variables are missing can take any form. I repeat, those variables are missing which can take any form. Therefore, what is going to happen? Since A and B are free to change, they can be 0, 0, they can be 0, 1, they can be 1, 0, they can be 1, 1. I hope you are clear with that. Similarly, here C is missing, guys. So C can be 0, C can be 1. But don't forget, during that, the variables which were there remains same. Meaning, for example, C throughout remains 1. C is never ever going to change because C is static here. C is static here. Similarly, AB bar is static here. AB bar is static means what? Even though C is changing from 0 to 1, AB bar remains 1, 0 only. Isn't it? And there is no question to go for a third term because it is by default static. All ABC are static. So we are going to get only one combination over here. That is 1. I hope you are clear with that. Now, you know that depending upon the combination of ABC, we get mean terms. We get mean terms. That is, over here, I can write this mean term. This is nothing but M1. This gives you what? Come on, guys. It is M3. This gives you what? This is M5. This gives you what? M7. Yes or no? 100 means it is 4. So it gives you M4. This gives you what? M5. Because 101 stands for M5. 001. Come on. 001 gives you M1. So now what you're going to do is, now you're going to write the answer, final answer. How to write final answer? See carefully. I can write y is equal to function of a comma b comma c, then write summation. Summation stands for sum. Small m stands for what? Mean terms. Now include all those mean terms. Include all those mean terms that you can see over here. Include all the mean terms that you can see over here, but do not duplicate the mean term. Duplicating mean terms means what? For example, if you have already considered m1, you don't have to write m1 twice. You have to consider m1 only once. If you don't understand, don't worry. Just pay attention what I'm trying to tell you. This is 1. So I'm going to consider 1. After 1, in ascending sequence, I can select 3. Okay, so I'm selecting 3. Then I can consider 4. So yes, I'm going to consider 4. Then I can consider 5. Yes, I can consider 5. Then there is 7. There is 7. Then 5, it's something we have already taken, so we are not going to reconsider this. 1, it's something which we have already taken, so we are not going to consider this again. I hope you got my point. So in a way, what I can write, y is equal to, okay, y is equal to, it is m1 plus m3 plus m4 plus m5 plus m7, right? Now for m1, what is the binary combination? 0, 0, 1. For 3, it is 0, 1, 1. For 4, it is 1, 0, 0. For 5, it is 1, 0, 1. And for 7, it is 1, 1, 1. Now you know that these combinations has come from ABC, guys. It has come from ABC. So since it is ABC equal to 0, 0, 1, now try to express them in terms of ABC. So I can write A bar, B bar, C plus. Next, 0, 1, 1. A is 0, so A has to be written as bar. But B and C are 1, so BC plus 1, 0, 0. So A is 1, A needs to be written as it is, but B and C are 0, 0, I can write them as B bar, C bar plus 101, guys. See, A is 1, so I can write A as it is. B is 0, I can write it as B bar. And again, C is 1, I can write C. Last term, guys. 111, I can write A, B, C. That's it. This is your final answer, guys. This is your final answer. Can't you see that? It has become literally canonical form. Canonical form as in every term, as you can see, not a single variable is missing. All the variables are covered in every term. That is A, B, C. That is in complemented form or uncomplemented form. That doesn't matter. I hope you understood this problem. Since you have understood this problem, that is how to convert the normal SOP into canonical SOP, let us understand how to convert the canonical POS form, that is normal POS to canonical POS form. Let us see in the next sum. So the next sum is waiting for you. Y is again function of A, B, C. As you can see, these is nothing but POS form. Check it out. This is POS form. As you can see, this is the first term, this is the second term, this is the third term. Third term, again, we are satisfied because all the variables are covered. Second term, we are unhappy because C is not covered. And look at the first term, A and C are not covered. So those who are covered, I can write them first. So for first term, B bar is covered. For second term, A and B are covered. And for third term, A bar, B bar and C bar are covered. I hope you get my point. Now the missing variables I'm going to express with the help of different color. See, A and C were missing. C is missing. Nothing is missing in third term. I hope you're getting my point. Now, don't forget, in max term, we consider exactly the reverse way of min term. That is, when the input variable is 0, we consider it in uncomplemented form. And the input variable, if appears to be 1, that is logic 1, we take a bar. Because ultimately, max term means combination of input in such a way that results in 0. So please don't forget that. So here, in first term, I'm talking about this first term, B bar is static. B bar remains 0. In second term, A and B are static. So they are going to remain what? They are going to remain 0, 0. Okay, now I made a mistake. I cannot write B bar as 0. B bar has to be written as 1. So I need to write B bar, isn't it? Because whenever the B value is equal to 1, we consider that as B bar in case of POS form. Please don't forget that. Next, A bar, B bar, C bar. Okay, all of them are bar, meaning that A, B, C values are static. They must be 1, 1, 1. And that's the reason why they are written in the form of A bar, B bar, C bar. So next, as you can see in the first term, A and C are free to change. Since A and C are free to change, I can write their possible combination as 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. Yes or no? In the second term, as you can see, C was missing. So C can take value as 0 also, 1 also. And for third term, we cannot do anything. All A, B, C are static. So they are not going to change. They are going to remain 1, 1, 1. Let me write the static term. Even though A and C are changing from 0, 0 to 0, 1 to 1, 0 to 1, 1, B remains 1 all the time. Here AB remains 0, 0 all the time. And now let's see, depending upon the decimal position, what max terms you are supposed to get. That is 0, 1, 0 means 2. So it is capital M2. 0, 1, 1, capital M3. 1, 1, 0. 1, 1, 0 stands for 6. So this is capital M6. 1, 1, it's 7. That is M7. Then for 0, 0, 0, you get what? Come on. Max term number 0. For 0, 0, 1, you get max term number 1. And the end, you get M7. Yes or no? Next. Now for you write y equal to pi. Pi stands for product. Please don't forget. Pi stands for what? Product. Product of what? Max terms. See, max terms are in the form of sum. I repeat. Max terms are in the form of sum. For which you take a product. So you get product of sum. So you have to now cover all the max terms over here. So in ascending sequence, I'll see 2. Then 3. Okay, there is 0 and 1 also. So I need to start with 0 and 1. So I'm going to consider first 0, then 1. So 0, 1, 2, 3. After 2, 3, there is 6 directly. And then there is 7. Again, the 7 is repeated. We are not going to consider that. You have to consider max term only once. Every max term has to be considered only once. Isn't it? Okay, please don't forget what capital M stands for, max term, what pi stands for, product. So now I can write y is equal to what? Okay, product of m naught dot m1 dot m2 dot m3 dot m6 dot m7. I hope you understood that. So here now I can write y equal to, now let us see m0. What is m0 stands for? M0 stands for all zeros. All zeros means what? It is a plus b plus c. I'm sure you remember that. Now dot, now I have to consider for m1. Look at m1 combination. M1 combination is 001, meaning that 001 means what? A plus b plus c bar, because wherever there is one, we take uncomplemented, or complemented, complemented. Dot m2, m2, look at the m2 combination, it is 010. So for 010, what do we take? Come on, it is a plus b bar plus c. Yes or no? Next, for m3. Now for m3, what I'm going to consider? 011 combination. 011 combination means what? It is a plus b bar plus c bar, because b and c are 1. Next, for m6. Now for m6, it is 110. 110 means what? It is a bar plus b bar plus c. Yes or no? And last, for m7. For 7, you get all ones. All ones means it has to be complemented as a bar plus b bar plus c bar, because ultimately you want 0. Please don't forget that. And now whatever I have written is nothing but a canonical POS form. You can claim that this is a canonical form, because in every term you can see all three variables are covered, maybe in complemented or uncomplemented form. So I'm sure you have understood now what is min term, max term, how to use them, how to write the logical equations with the help of min terms and max terms that we have seen in the previous videos. And in this video we have seen how to write SOP in canonical as well as non-canonical form, as well as how to convert the non-canonical form to canonical form, whether it is SOP or POS. Thank you.